गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
गुड इवनिंग
या वन मिनट।
मैम दिस इज शैनियो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस यू आर ऑडिबल मैम।
थैंक यू मैम।
What is the question I have asked you all to Google in the last class? Can anybody remember? I forgot. Anybody remembers what I asked you all to Google? You're able to see slide? Can you see the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
So what is the... I have asked you all to Google something. Anybody was able to Google? I too forgot what I have asked you all. Okay. So let us start, continue with the chapter. So in the last class, we have studied about the components in the ecosystem, different types of ecosystems, and what is the about the each component in the ecosystem, that is abiotic component and the biotic component. Biotic component again is producers, consumers, decomposers, and finally about the importance of the or functions of the ecosystem. Okay, now in today's class we'll see what is a food chain, what is a food web, and also conclude this chapter. So what is a food chain? I think so all of you must be studying about this from class 8 or class 7. Have you heard about this word? Have you heard about this word?
Yes, ma'am.
So a food chain, this is the definition for the food chain. And please remember, this is a very important answer. Either they will be giving you all as what is a food chain and give example of the food chain, or they will be giving you as explain the difference between a food chain and the food web with example. Okay, so this is a very important 3 marks answer. Okay, so let us start. A food chain, what is the proper definition for the food chain? 1 minute, let me take a pointer. So a food chain is the flow of food energy from one organism to the next and to the next and so on. So a flow, what is a food chain? It is nothing but a flow of energy from one organism to the next organism. Like from grass to deer, deer to lion. So usually the food chain starts with the plants. Why plants? Because they are producers, they can prepare their own food with the help of sunlight, because they are autotrophs. So they don't depend on anything for their food. They use sunlight, and by help of photosynthesis, they can prepare their own food. So always the food chain starts with the producers, then ends with the carnivores. So coming to the, so let me first tell you all, 1 minute. So always the producer, the food chain starts with the producer. So food, always the food chain starts with the producer. Producers are nothing but the autotrophs, that is the plants, the water producers, the organisms that can prepare their own food are called as producers. So usually the green plants, blue-green algae, all of these are their producers. Next comes the consumers. So consumers are those which depend on their producers based on the levels. Now the consumers are divided into 4 or 5 different levels, like primary consumer, secondary consumer, tertiary consumer, and quaternary consumer. So basically all these primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary are called as consumers. So what are consumers? Broadly they are called as consumers are those which depend on the producers. So what are consumers? Mostly all the animals. All the animals are called as consumers. But why they are characterized is they are divided into subgroups like primary consumer, secondary consumer, tertiary consumer, and quaternary. So after producers, so I'll put the arrow in this way. Okay. After the, so first always starts the producers. So after that comes the primary consumer. Because primary consumers are those which depend on the producers. So what are these? Primary consumers are always herbivore animals. Can you give examples of herbivorous animals? Means they are not flesh-eating animals. Can any of you give examples? What are herbivorous animals? All of you are there? Harita, dear, can you give? Remaining also, please answer. Please answer. Daniel, you can answer.
Cow and deer.
Huh?
And cow.
Cow. Any more herbivorous animals? Atrav? Any more herbivore? Can you give example of herbivorous animal? All of you, please unmute yourself. In school, you be like this only. Tell. If we are having a classroom class, you people will be answering no. Because of this, we are having online classes. You should, people will be able to answer. You should answer. Then only I will be knowing no, whether you are able to understand the topic or not. If it's wrong also, I'm not going to tell you anything. You know that. Why are you scared? Please unlock yourselves, all of you. Let us have a good communication class. Only if I be teaching and you be silent, it is not going to work in this way. Always the class should be in a such a way, when I tell you the class, the concept should go into your mind. That is how the class should be conducted. I be talking, you be silent. That's not going, that is not the way, ma. Not only in 10th class, in future classes also, this is not going to work out for you all. Okay, all of you unmute yourself.
whether you are giving me sound or whatever it is, please unmute yourself first of all. I'm seeing who is unmuting, who is not unmuting. I can visualize it. First, unmute yourself, all of you. Yes, unmute yourself. Pooja, you have started. Unmute. All of you. Now tell me. Atrav, please answer me. Examples of herbivorous animals. Atrav, can you hear me? So herbivorous animals means animals which feed on the plants. Means they are not man-eating or flesh-eating animals. Those we categorize them as the herbivorous animals. Usually deer, cow, buffaloes, all these comes as the herbivorous animals. So followed by herbivorous animals are the next set of consumers which we call as secondary consumers, which depend on the primary consumers for their food. So what are secondary consumers? These are the carnivorous animals. These are the flesh-eating animals. But they are smaller animals. So in carnivores, we have a smaller one as well as the bigger ones. For example, frog. Frog can be considered as a secondary consumer. In some food chain, snake also can be considered as a secondary consumer. Okay? So whatever it is, depending on the chain, whether chain is going on, extending or whatever it is, secondary consumers are the usually the animals are the flesh-eating animals. So based on the size and everything, if the chain extends more, means there is some other animal which depends on the secondary consumer, you should then it goes into the territory. If some other animal depends,
ma'am, I can't hear you.
Can you hear me? Yes?
Yes,
some problem has happened. Okay, 1 minute. Now you can see the slide?
Yes.
So one level means whether it is producer. So this can be considered as a one single level. producers can be considered as one single level. Again, primary consumers can be considered as, so level is known as trophic. So each, there are different stages of the trophic level. Okay, the food chain can be as simple as well as long or lengthy also. So there is no need, but always the food chain, simple one, starts with the producer, followed by a primary consumer, and always ends with a secondary consumer. This is a very simple food chain. So in some food chains, it can, as I showed you all, it can go on to the tertiary and quaternary consumers also. So hope all of you have understood it. Have you understood? Yes or no? At least tell me that. So here, let us see the few. So let us see the one of the few examples. So first example is the simple food chain, where it starts with the grass. Grass is a producer, followed by deer. Deer is a primary consumer, and finally ends with the secondary consumer, that is the lion. Next one is the second food chain. Second example. Again, here it starts with the grass. Next, followed by insects. Insects also feed on the grass. So insects are the primary consumers here. Next coming, followed by the secondary consumer. Okay. That is the frogs. Frogs feeds on the insects. Next, snakes. Snakes are the tertiary consumer over here. Snakes feeds on the frogs. Next one, another example. Again, grass is the starting producer. Next, moth. That is the butterfly. That depends on the grass or whatever it is for its food. Followed by secondary consumer, frog. Frog depends on the moth for its food. Snakes depends on the frog for its food. Finally, hog depends on the snake for its food. So all this is finally called as the food chain. Okay. Finally, always the quaternary consumer will be ended by a decomposer. Because always at the end, after we die, whatever dies, it should be, the body should be decomposed. So the final end of the food chain always will be a decomposer. Okay. Any doubts still here? Any doubts?
No, no.
Have you noted it down?
Noted.
So these are the different food chains examples I have given you all. So you can see here, this is a terrestrial food chain. This is the marine food chain. You can see terrestrial means land food chain. And this is the water food chain. First, we'll start with the land. Primary consumers in the land is always a plant, followed by a herbivore. Here you can see moth, followed by a secondary consumer. That is the frog or whatever it is, depends on these carnivores. Next, snake depends on the frog. And finally, hog depends on the snake. Whereas coming to the marine food chain, that is the water food chain, phytoplanktons means the plants which are present in the water or at the bottom or whatever it is are known as the phytoplanktons. Okay, phytoplanktons are the prime producers, whereas zooplanktons, that is the small animals which depends on these plants for their food, are known as zooplanktons. Finally, carnivores. That is the fish depends on these zooplanktons. Next, bigger fish depends on the smaller fish. And finally, more bigs like whales depend on the smaller fish. This is the food chain for the marine, and this is the food chain for the land animals. So based on it, each of you, can you give me an example of one food chain? Whoever mic is not working, please put a dash and give me in the chat box. I want all the 8 participants to give me. And your time starts now. It's only 1 to 2 minutes. I want to complete this chapter. Make it fast. Give one example. A small or bigger, small food chain or bigger food chain, no problem. Give me an example. Done, all of you? Start typing. All of you, 9 participants. Start typing, or you unmute yourself and tell me the example and close. I'll ask Raghav sir to join this class now. I'll call him and ask him to join. Are you done, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, please. If you are done, you can open your mic and tell me, or you can, if your mic is not working, you can also give me a chat reply. Yes, I'm seeing. Harita, grass, rapid, fox. Yes, correct. Atrav, rice. Rice, rat, crow. Rice cannot be, rice is a seed, ma. You should write plant only at the beginning, Atrav. You
okay,
cannot
ma'am.
Write rice.
Okay, ma'am.
Plant you write. Plant or rice, whatever it is, you can write it. Okay? Don't write rice. Nas, grass, deer, lion. That is common, Amrita, okay? Plants, butterfly, frog, snake, grass, buffalo, lion. Okay. Atrav, okay, ma'am. Remaining people? San, you have answered. Akshita, Amrita, Atrav, and Harita. Remaining. Nectar flower, butterfly, small birds. Bird, you cannot keep Durlav. You can keep other one. You can keep cat. You can, Durlav, you, the fourth one is wrong. You can keep a cat or you can keep anything. So cat can vary from a secondary to territory also. Or dog also you can keep. Okay, Durlav? Next, Pooja. Grass, grasshopper. Bird, snake, snake, oval. Yes, correct. You went up to the quaternary. Next, remaining. Who are there still? Akshita? I think so. You did not message me. Akshita did. Amrita did. Atrav did. Harita did. Okay. I see who are left out still. Durlav did, Harita, Pooja did. Okay. Janni left. Okay. Now coming to the significance of this food chains. So why this food chain is very important? Because the food chain helps us to study the relationship. Okay, it helps us to know the relationship between the organisms and their interactions. So it helps us to understand the food relationships and interactions between the different organisms, and also helps us to transfer the energy from one living component to the other living component. Okay, suppose for example, only plants are there. Okay, next only deers are there. For next other levels are not there. What will happen? What will happen? Anybody has idea? At that point, only the energy is stopped. Okay, there will be no further transfer of energy. Okay, so due to that, and finally, it may end as a decompose again, goes to the plants. So that chain should be maintained, means the transfer of energy should be maintaining in various living components of the ecosystem. So if the sunlight, for example, always starting energy is sunlight, okay? With so much of sunlight is enters into the earth. Only small percentage of energy is captured by the plants. Okay, if that energy is not captured, what will happen? As energy, what will happen? If there's a lot of sun energy entering into the earth. If plants are not there, what we used to have, what will happen? What will happen? Tell me. I cannot hear you, ma. Be slowly, tell me. You are being very fast.
From the herbivores do not have any food to eat.
Carnivores will not have any food to eat. But what will happen to the earth? So much of sun energy is there. No plants are there to trap that energy. What will happen? It will become a hot ball because we have started like a hot ball. Slowly the plants have started to develop and they are able to trap the solar energy. Okay, that energy is being passed on from one trophic level to the other trophic level. So if that one is not done, what will be there? There will be no new species will be formed. Nothing will be there. Okay. So this energy transfers helps between the various living components, helps to maintain the ecosystem or the biosphere. So they give dynamicity to the ecosystem. They give a structure and framework to the ecosystem. And also sometimes some prones are there, some cons are there for this for significance. Sometimes including energy, sometimes due to our pollution, toxic components also pass from one food chain, trophic level to the other trophic level, and it can be harmful to us. That we'll be discussing what in the further slides. Are you able to understand? So let us move on to the next topic, that is the food web. So what is the food web? Food web is nothing but the interconnection of a food chain. Means two or three food chain will be interconnected and establish a network relationship or network between these food chain, and this is called as a food web. Means in a food web, so in food chain always one organism will be occupying only one sector in a food chain. Whereas in food web, it can occupy two or three positions in a food chain. Okay. So let us see what is a food chain and what is a food web. Here you can see in a picture, one I'll be describing to you. So plants always are the primary ones. So this plant can be, here it can be consumed by a moth, a bigger bug, and finally it will be consumed by the birds and finally eagle. Whereas this one again, grasshopper can also be consumed by the bird. So again, it will be consumed by the eagle. So again, here you can see this grasshopper can be consumed by the rat also. Again, this rat can be consumed by the eagle. So all this will be interconnected so that it will be stabilizing. Always only rat only should eat the grasshopper, or rat only rat can eat the grasshopper. It's not like that. Okay. So it can be interconnected. Like How can I explain you all? There are four or five restaurants around your home. Restaurant A, restaurant B, restaurant C, restaurant D. Restaurant A gives you all pani puri. Restaurant B gives you all noodles. Restaurant C gives you all, what I can tell you all, any good food? Manchuria, okay. And restaurant D gives you all ice cream. So you are with two children in your family. Okay, your brother and one sister. Okay, brother goes to the pani puri shop and you go to the ice cream shop. But sometimes brother also can come to the ice cream shop. Okay, he eats a pani puri and also can come to the ice cream shop. Where you, I, sisters can go to noodle shop also. You can, you all together can, both of y'all can go to manchuria shop also. So it's like that. So all this is a food chain. Sorry, food web. Understood? Have you all understood?
Yes.
Any doubts? Any doubts?
No.
Okay. So please now write down the difference between a food chain and a food web. This is the difference between a food chain and a food web. Food chain is defined as the phenomenon of transfer of energy through a series of organisms following on a successive trophic levels. Whereas food web is an interconnection of food chain which shares the relationship between them. In food chains, usually the member of the higher trophic level always feed on a simple organisms of the lower trophic level. Whereas in food web, members of higher trophic level can feed upon many organisms of a lower trophic level. In food chain, separate and isolated food chains increase the instability of the ecosystem. Whereas in food web, stability of the ecosystem increases by the presence of these complex food webs. I'll explain you all this statement. For example, grass is there. Grass is always 1 minute. Grass is always fed by a deer. And this one is always fed by lion only. What will happen after some time? Can you tell me? In a small plot of land, there is a grass. Grass will be always fed by the deer. So there are three or four deer.
When the deer will start consuming the entire grass and there will not be any grass left out.
Yes. Again, but if the lion continuously feed on the, it finally kill off all these three or four deer, what will happen?
Mom, then the lions will not have any food to eat.
Yes, the lions will not have a food to eat. So to stabilize this, now this grass can also be eaten by a moth. Am I right? Okay. So moths will be again eaten by a bird. Moths will not consume all the grass. So to stabilize this one, lions can feed again on birds also. So to stabilize this one, to bring the stability, the food web is required so that it increases the this increases the stability by the presence of complex food webs. So in case of food chain, as all of us know, it has only one chain, whereas it, food web contains many chains. Removal of one group of organism, suppose we remove the deer, as the food chain will be altered or stopped or whatever it is. Suppose here deer is removed, as the food chain will be completely disturbed. But when there is a food web, if we remove a bird or anything also, they will be, the stability will not be disturbed, and also they will be they will not be having any much issues if it's a food web. So this is the difference between a food chain and a food web. Understood? Food chain is mainly required for the flow of energy, whereas food web is required to maintain the stability and diversity in the ecosystem. You have any doubts? Hope all of you have noted down. Shall I move on to the next slide? So let us move to the second one. Next one. So coming to the trophic levels. So as I have already discussed again, let us discuss it. So each level is known as a trophic. So each step in the food chain, where the energy of the food energy takes place, where the transfer of the food energy takes place, is called as the trophic level. So this is the definition for the trophic level. Each step in the food chain where transfer of food energy takes place is called as a trophic level. So always the first trophic level will be the producers. The second one will be the primary consumers. Third will be always the secondary consumers. And fourth will be the tertiary consumer. So usually it does not exist more than four or five levels. So if we put in a form of a pyramid, if we put one above the other, we'll get a pyramid. Because always the number of producers will be more, because we have lots of grassland. Slowly the number of the herbivores will be more compared to that of the primary. Again, secondary, primary will be more compared to the secondary consumers or whatever it is. Sorry, tertiary consumers or whatever it is. So if we put, we call these as the ecological pyramids. So here again, please remember, when we put in a form of the pyramid, the transfer of energy, the energy will be always very high in the first trophic level, that is at the producers. The energy is very high at the first trophic level, and as it goes up, the energy becomes low. So always the flow of energy is upward, in upward direction only, and only in a unidirectional manner. Means it will not come down. It will not flow in both directions. It is always in the upward direction, in a unidirectional manner only. So from first, it will be very high. Energy will be very high at the first trophic level, that is at the producers. As it goes on, as it reaches the tertiary consumer, the energy becomes low. In the same way, the population will be very high. You can see here in this pyramid, the population will be very high in case of producers. As we go up, the population of the organisms becomes very low, small. Shall I move on? Have you noted the pyramids?
Yes.
No need to draw the diagrams. We can simply note the pyramids. Next, this is the important one mark bit, or you will be getting as a problem also. Okay, this is only a problem you will be getting in biology. Okay, so let us see. The flow of energy, as I told you, is unidirectional only. That is from upward direction only. So you please see. So this is the sun. So this is the sun. The sun generates solar energy. Okay. So this solar energy is captured by the producers, that is the plant. So how much it captures? So whatever the total energy released by the sun, only 1% is captured by the progestins. Please remember, only 1% is captured by the producers. From producers to the consumers, as it goes on, that only 10% of energy will be transferred to the second level. Only 10% of the energy will be transferred from one trophic level to the next trophic level. So due to that, always energy will be high near the producers, whereas it goes to the tip of the pyramid, the energy will be very low. Now here I'll give you one example. So the sun's solar energy is 10 lakhs. What is the percentage of energy captured by the producer? Can anybody tell? What is the percentage of energy captured by the producers?
Mom, 1%.
That one, I want the sun solar energy is 10 lakhs. I want now in a calculation. What is the percentage? What is the energy? How much energy will be there in the producer? No.
1 lakh.
How much?
1 lakh. 1 lakh.
1 lakh. How much is 1%? Yes, 10,000. Able to understand all of you? So yes, 1% will be here 10,000. So now, how much energy will be there in the primary consumer? Harita, correct, 10,000. How much energy will be there in the primary consumer now?
100.
Yes. 100. Once again, calculate. Only 10% of 10,000 will be going. So how much energy will be there?
Ma'am, 1,000%.
Yes, 1,000. Means 90,000 will be present near the producer itself. Only 10% of 10,000 will be going. So it will be 1,000. Next, secondary consumers. Again.
100%.
Yes, 100%. Tertiary?
10%.
Yes, 10. Able to understand all of you? So only 1% will be captured by the producers. Then from whatever they captured, only 10% will be going to the next level. 90% will be remaining with that level only. Okay, so this is how you need to calculate. Now I'll give you another example, another number. So you should be telling me what will be the final energy at the quaternary consumer level. I want at the quaternary consumer level. So this is the amount of energy the sun is being producing. So what will be there at the quaternary consumer? Last peak for tropic level. All of you, please fast give me the chat answer. Not 10,000, Harita. I ask you final answer, that is quaternary consumer. I want not in percentages. I want only in energy. I gave you all 10 lakhs kilojoules. Is there or kilocalories? Is the energy released from the sun? So finally, how much energy will be transferred to the quaternary consumers? How much energy will be there near the quaternary consumer? Any more answers? You are right, Harita. Any more? Oh, I want all answers, so I'm not discussing. Remaining people, make fast calculations. Very easy one. If this you are not going to work, maths and science, physics will be more difficult for you. Come on. Remaining people, fast, it's already 6:20. So what is the, except Harita, remaining answer? What will be the per se, how much energy will be trapped by the producer? I'll definitely ask Raghavan sir to join the class now. Few people are not answering. How much energy will be trapped by the producer? I'll ask Raghavan sir, what sir, you're not teaching maths or to these people. How much of energy is trapped by the producer? Okay, I'm calling sir, but really becoming difficult. You people are not answering. I am not able to know whether you people are able to understand or not. You are keeping very silent, all of you. Finally, only 7 participants are remaining. Where are remaining? How much of energy is trapped by the producer? Please calculate. Only 1% means how much we will get.
Ma'am, are you asking about the fourth consumer?
Who is answering?
Ma'am, Harita.
Huh?
Harita.
Harita, you don't answer. Remaining people, remaining say, 6 members.
Hello, sir. Sir, class join on sir. Yes, answer for you, but later. Oxer, join on sir.
How much energy is transferred? Where are the remaining? Why other people have left already? Sanyu, why he left the class? Aditi, how much energy is transferred here? Trapped by the producer? Unmute yourself. Not 10. 1% means how much? Do calculation. 1% means how much? I have given 10 lakhs kilo, 10 lakhs of energy, 10 lakh kg. 1% means how much?
10,000.
Akshita?
Yes, ma'am.
How much energy is transferred, trapped by the producer?
₹10,000, ma'am.
Yes, that is what I'm asking. So 1% means here you should write by into, if you divide into 1/100, you will get 10,000. Next, how much will be going to the primary producer? Answer, all of you. How much will be going to the primary producer? Harita, you don't answer. How much amount of energy will go to the primary producer? Give me a chat answer at least. Only 10% will go. How much will be there near the primary producer?
1,000, ma'am.
1,000. Remaining people don't want to answer. Next. Atrav, how much will be there near the secondary producer? 1,000. How much energy will be transferred to the secondary producer? 10% of it means how much? Yes, 100. Next, tertiary producer. How much energy will be transferred?
10, ma'am.
10. And finally, quaternary?
1.
This is your answer, should be 1 kilojoule. Nobody is answering. So, this usually comes as your 1 mark question. Or now we don't know what is the pattern because this is a subjective topic. It may come as a 1 mark question or 2 marks or 3 marks question. The only calculations you have in the biology part. So sometimes they give you only the what is the energy present in the producer level. Then they ask you how much energy will be transferred to the tertiary level. So they can ask you in any levels. All of you understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Only Harita answers. Remaining people are not even answering. Shall I move on to the next topic?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is the 10, this transfer of energy is known as the 10% law. That is what we have now studied. So the 10% law, what it says, only 10% of energy is transferred to the next level, whereas 90% remains in the same tropic level. This is what we have studied and it will be discussed. So next comes to the biomagnification. I have been telling you all that we'll be discussing in the next class from the previous class itself. So what is biomagnification means? It is the toxic chemicals will be gone eliminating as it reaches the higher levels. The toxic will be, so the highest levels will be having lot of toxic chemicals. Means the percentage or whatever ppms will be more in case of the higher trophic level. So this again is an important 3 marks question. So what is biomagnification? First, the definition. The increase in the concentration of harmful chemicals in the bodies of the organism at a higher trophic levels is called as the biomagnification. So there will be an increase in the concentration as the pesticides, for example, we take toxic components. The example is pesticide. As it goes on moving, the higher trophic levels will be having higher concentration of pesticides in the body compared to the lower trophic level. And this is called as the biomagnification. So usually what they do is they ask you all the definition of biomagnification and they ask you all to write an example of the biomagnification. So for example, you can take here the one of the best example. Okay, DTT is a one type of a pesticide. DTT means that what they spray when anybody is having a political rally or whatever it is, some white powder is sprayed beside the roads. Have anybody observed it?
Yes, ma'am.
Have anybody observed it?
Yes, ma'am.
So that is called as, that powder is known as DTT. Okay, it is actually a toxic component. Many countries have banned it, but India is still using it. So first this component will be seeping into the water. So in the water, it will be only 0.0003 ppm only. Ppm is one of the units. First, it will go to the zooplanktons. Now, it gets accumulated in the zooplanktons. It will be 0.04. Now, it will go to the, because the small fish depend on the zooplanktons. Okay, it will be 0.5 ppm. Next, large fish depend on the small fish. It will be 2 ppm. Next, eagles depend on the bigger fish. That may be 25 ppm. Eagles also not. We human beings, if we consume the fish also, this DTT will be getting accumulated in our bodies. So the concentration of the pesticide will be go on increasing when we move from the smaller trophic levels to the higher trophic level. So this is known as biomagnification or also known as bioconcentration also.
Okay.
So what is biomagnification? Except Harita, please others answer. One of you. What is biomagnification?
Guys, anybody can answer? Are you guys there in the
please.
Sanyu, yes, please continue. You are speaking something.
Increase in toxic materials in the body of organism is known as biomagnification.
Increase in toxic chemicals in what levels?
Trophic levels.
At higher levels. Higher trophic levels.
Okay.
It's known as biomagnification. And what you can give the DDT as an example, or you simply can put a pesticide and give an example also in the food chain itself. So what are the examples of for the highest trophic levels? It can usually be, mostly will be the higher carnivorous animals, like we human beings, eagles, lions, tigers. These comes at the highest trophic level. So why we call it a toxic? Because these cannot be degraded. Because it cannot be degraded. Although we get decomposed, after we die, the decomposers will be degrading our body. These toxic components which got accumulated will not be able to be degraded. And this may be also harmful to us. So only we are asking to shift to the organic food, where there will be no toxic, because they are growing in a non-toxic growing them in a where there are no pesticides are used. So we are the people are being nowadays being asked to eat those organic food, or government is promoting to go for a terrace gardening. So I hope all of you understood this topic. Shall I move on to the next slide? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So next, coming to the last part of this lesson, human activities, what are the human activities? The activities due to us, how it's affecting the environment. Can you describe any of them? Can you give examples? Huh?
Deforestation, ma'am.
Deforestation? Any more?
Mining.
Any more?
Pollution.
Pollution?
Dumping of waste materials.
Dumping of waste materials. So, mostly the pollution is, as you all told you, as your people have told, as they are mostly the activities we do nowadays is affecting our surrounding environment. There is an increase of pollution. There is increase of carbon monoxide levels in the air. How many of you watch the news where you see the this much of percentage, this much of ppm of harmful air is being noted in Delhi? Have you all, anybody listened to the NDTV news? This much PPPMs of CO levels are there in the Delhi air. It is highly polluted. Even how much is there in Chennai nowadays, they even keeping a signboards. Have anybody of you seen? Even in Chennai, there is one place where they put the signboard. How much pollution is there in the air? PPM means parts per millennium. Okay, so these activities, whatever due to our technology or whatever it is due to our over and achievements and advancements, we are now actually destroying our surrounding ecosystem, and also due to that, lot of environmental problems are being caused. And one of them is the ozone. Okay, depletion of the ozone layer. So what is a ozone? Actually, ozone layer is a protective layer. It's a protective layer around the earth which absorbs the harmful UV rays. So when it prevents the entry of the UV rays. UV rays means ultraviolet rays. Why UV rays are harmful is because these, if we fall directly on us, it usually causes us skin cancer. Sometimes it causes us cataracts, weakens our immune system, and also cause destruction to the plants also. So only In for women, for everybody nowadays, when we go out, they're asking us to put UV creams, sunscreens, which can block the entry of UV rays or damage our skin or darken our skin. Okay? So this layer plays a very important role. It present in a stratosphere region. Okay? So it acts as a blanket and prevents or filters the rays which are coming from the sun. So only visible rays will be and falling on the earth. Whereas the UV rays and other rays will be blocked. But what happens here is, in first or in 1985, in Antarctica region, we have seen a decline in the ozone layer. Okay. And this term is known as ozone hole. Okay. So why this is going to be declined is because of presence of chlorofluorocarbons. Extensive use of the CFCs has caused decrease the thickness of the ozone layer. And slowly, due to that, lot of UV rays started to fall on the earth. So first, let us see how ozone is formed. Okay. So formation of the ozone is a photochemical reaction. The ozone, oxygen is there. Oxygen, what will happen? Oxygen, what is the molecular weight of oxygen? Or how the oxygen is represented as? Usually it is represented as O2. So first, due to wavelength, the ozone oxygen will be splitted as a single molecule, O plus O. Now this O, single O, we call it as a reactive O. Okay, this O mixes with the oxygen, that is O2, and forms into a O3. So O3 is nothing but a ozone. Ozone is nothing, which is a combination. It contains three oxygen molecules. Ozone contains three oxygen molecules. So usually the oxygen, O3, is a poisonous gas. If it's present on the ground level, usually is a poisonous gas. But as it forms a layer near the stratosphere, it helps us to block the UV rays from entering into the ozone of entering towards the Earth's atmosphere, to the lower Earth's atmosphere. So, but as we the pollutants, as we have discussed, one of the main pollutants is the chlorofluorocarbons. So what are these chlorofluorocarbons are? These are the inert chemicals mostly used in refrigerators, in fire extinguishers, the cooling element we call in the refrigerator. If anybody has come for repair of the refrigerators, they'll call a cooling element. Now it is replaced with other chemical. This cooling element, this contains chlorofluorocarbons. So what it will be doing is, now how will this ozone form? First, the O2 will be broken down into two oxygen molecules, two reactive oxygen molecules. This reactive oxygen molecule will be reacting with the normal oxygen and forms into the O3. But here, what will happen if there is an excess of this CFCs, that is chlorofluorocarbons? They will be reacting because this chlorofluorocarbons contain chlorine. It will react with the oxygen and forms into a oxide of the chlorine or chlorine oxide. So due to that, the formation of the ozone will be coming, gone, be destroying. So what happened is, to prevent this, UNEP, United Nations Environmental Program, has made agreement in 1968, that is in a Tokyo, which we call it as Kyoto Protocol, by all the countries to replace the CFCs or prevent the use of the CFCs to increase or to prevent the formation of these ozone holes or decrease the ozone thickness. And again, this is another important one mark question. It's in your textbook itself. UNEP, United Nations Environmental Program, it has organized a conference known as Kyoto Protocol. In this conference, in year 1986, they have come to an agreement that to freeze or to replace the CFCs with other chemical which is less harmful to our environment and protect the ozone layer. All of you have understood? Yes, all of you have understood?
Yes, ma'am. Understood.
Yes, ma'am.
You have any doubts?
No doubt.
No doubt.
Huh? You have any doubts?
No doubt, ma'am.
Who is answering? You're having a test in physics now?
Yes, ma'am.
2 minutes, I'll be winding up. Because we are taking long, no? Only last slide is there. Let me wind up this one so that the chapter will be completed. In next class, we can discuss the questions. Or if you have the test, I'll complete in the next class. No problem. Only this last one is left out. All of you have any doubts? So when is your exam? I told you all I'll be conducting another exam in September. Only multiple choice questions from life process.
You said 3rd September, ma'am.
Huh? 3rd September. So all of you remember?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, with this I'll close, wind up the class. In the next class, we can complete this chapter.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.